confronting this musical ensemble, a man who needs no introduction, so I'm not going to give him one, Rob Benedict!
Hey, everybody! Vegas! 2023! Let's do it!
Julie McNiven was here.
Tyler J. But I mean, we haven't seen McNiven in a long time.
Yeah, we haven't seen McNiven in a while.
Rob and I don't look at the program.
We don't look at the program.
No, this is how we find out. This is actually a lot of times, this is how we know that we're invited. We have to go here. Because we just follow the concert, we just follow the truck.
Yeah.
And we come out here and they give us a microphone and they're like, oh, we're actually being paid. That's
yeah.
Cool.
I rode the plane with Rosenbaum and he was asking me who else was here this week and I said, I don't know.
I know the band will be here.
I didn't know you were coming.
I wouldn't. Yeah, that's true. Rob last night was like, so are you going to be in Vegas?
I'm
like,
I'm in the room
next to you. Oh, well then knock it off. Is everybody enjoying their Vegas experience thus far? How many of you are doing your very first doctored hybrid supernatural convention? I mean, I guess everybody's doing their first hybrid supernatural. Yeah, you know what? Actually, we're all doing our first hybrid. But anything supernaturally themed, who's doing their first one? Who's doing their first supernatural anything? I like it. That's a lot of you. I want you, during the panels, to only ask Keegan about episodes of Supernatural he's in. Just, you can just frame it that way. I think he'd really appreciate it. This
now,
is awesome.
You've directed most of the people on that banner.
I've directed, from the new people, I've directed, well, Mitch, I'm not counting Mitch as new, but he hasn't been around
right.
Well, so Mitch Pelletti, I've directed Mitch, I've directed Tom Welling,
uh-huh.
I have not directed Michael Rosenbaum.
No, not yet.
I know Michael Rosenbaum.
Sure.
I haven't directed Tom.
Right.
But you know, later on, backstage, he'll ask me where the bathroom is, I'll direct him to the restroom, and I can check that box.
Sure. Right? Good.
And then I haven't directed Kat. I have directed Keegan.
Yeah, you directed Keegan.
So, and I've directed you.
You directed me?
I haven't directed you guys yet, but I have.
No,
Kings of Con.
You directed.
I directed them.
Kings of Con. Kings of Con. You directed the band?
Yeah.
You directed Jensen and Jared, Misha and Ruth.
Yeah.
Kim.
Yeah.
You directed Kim.
Kim, Brianna, David, Sam.
Wow, you're real.
Jake.
You're real pushy. Just directing everybody.
Yeah, I really am. You know what?
What a know-it-all.
I have a problem, and I need help. But you don't need help because you're here in Vegas. Doing 4 days, 4 days, I repeat, 4 days. Metrically, they call that a shitload of days, is what they call that.
And that's the only show we do 4 days.
I mean, this is unbelievable. You and I used to do all 4 days.
We used to do them.
And right now, we'd be a shell of a set of guys up here.
Yeah.
We'd just be like crawling on and gripping the mic and using it to stabilize.
I never went back to 100% after those years.
No. We're a solid 72, though, dude.
Yeah.
Solid 72% of who we used to be before we started doing Vegas. How many of you are going to attend what I like to think of the high watermark of the event? That's when this band takes over the entire venue and makes this special. Rob, I don't want to overspeak because, you know, I'm just a fan. But I think you got a lot of guests showing up tonight.
We got a lot of fun guests tonight, yeah. Including a returning, a man, the prodigal son who hasn't been with us in a while, Richard Spade Jr.
Ooh!
Yeah.
That'll be fun.
Gonna be there. Gonna sing.
That's awesome. You guys gonna play anything off the new record?
We're gonna play a lot off the new record. Yeah.
That's gonna be great.
A lot of and some of the hits. Some of the classics.
Are you saying that the new record doesn't have any hits on it?
No, I'm just saying. We love the new record.
We'll be playing the new record from beginning to end, and then some music you'll like.
I've never said that. That's not what I said at all. I said the opposite of that.
It's like that old vaudeville joke. I'd rather be here with you people today than with the best people in the world. And I mean that.
That's exactly what it's like. Thank you, Rich.
I just woke up the robot.
And this weekend you'll see the sales of the new album go down.
Taking a nosedive. But hey, at least it made a headline. Speaking of headlines, let's not bury it. It's New Jersey's favorite son, Billy Branham's birthday. He just found out last night that he's from New Jersey. We're celebrating that.
Really?
Well, there's a thing. So here's the thing.
Is that
the
thing that you thought he was from New Jersey and he's not?
It's a lot. For many years early on, he brought this whole New Jersey vibe with him. Everywhere he went, everybody talked about it.
Nobody ever talked about it.
And so I naturally just fell for it and assumed he was from Jersey. And on stage, one time at his birthday, made up in Jersey, made a big dog and pony show about Local Boy Makes Good, Billy Moran, New Jersey, and did a whole spiel, only to turn around and find Johnny Deadpan over here going like, I'm not from Jersey. Killed the whole bit. No butted me, altered my improv. But now it's stuck in my brain that he's from Jersey. And it's not, you know, it's really a compliment. It elevates Jersey. Like, you're doing Jersey a favor. If you would just claim that as your hometown, I mean, yay Jersey. You know what I mean? It's a win for Jersey. But I guess if you want to go with your actual hometown, I mean, that's a choice.
You know, Jersey's a state.
What's
right?
It going to be? Are you from Jersey or are you not from Jersey?
He's not from Jersey.
No, let him decide. He's the birthday boy. Are you from Jersey?
Yes.
Thank you! New Jersey's favorite son, Billy Moran, celebrating birthday all weekend long. It's MoranCon. This is just the first moment of it. We're so excited that you could be here for MoranCon. But ladies and gentlemen, he's not the only person in this band. We also have over there on the bass guitar, we have Mr. Michael Mora playing the big band. And then you got, of course, you know, Billy Moran is Morcon. But let's not forget, Mr. New Jersey himself, Robert Patrick Benedict, singing Lady Day, what you got? And I respect, Rob, wrap this thing up, let's get this party going, shall we?
I got soul, but I'm not a soldier. I got soul, but I'm not a soldier. I got soul, but I'm not a soldier.
I mean, they are just chewy too. You can hear the Jersey.
Yeah, you can hear it.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. Almost in a Las Vegas sort of sense.
Speaking of
Jersey.
MoranCon.
Speaking of Jersey.
Billy MoranCon. Our next three guests. The best way to start a show ever with our next three guests. Ironically, all of them hailing from the great state of New Jersey. Put your hands together. For Brianna Buckmaster, Jim Rogers, and Samantha. Sing Happy Birthday to Billy, and this will be the first of 43 times we sing Happy Birthday.
Yes, that sounds like
so
heaven for Billy.
So join us while you singing Happy Birthday, Billy. Here we go.
This is exactly what you wanted for your birthday, right?
Hey man,
we can fix
day's
that.
Day's not over.
I mean, it's a rule, isn't it?
I have this heart. I need everything to be centered here.
Oh,
do you know what I mean? As we were just having this discussion backstage. Oh, good morrow to you all.
And I'm gonna stand.
Is that how you're gonna do the panel? Just like this? How's everybody doing today?
Hey,
how are we?
Look, it's us.
Oh. That's for our OnlyFans. Not our OnlyFans, but our OnlyFans. Hey man, you gotta make money somehow. Is everybody awake this morning? Are we feeling a little fragile?
Tender.
Have we been Vegas'd appropriately? Yes,
who is
my
karaoke
answer. Seven of you. Nice. Right. Love right. that. And everybody's
it
tuckered.
Was fun. It was super fun.
It was so fun. I went out to... Let's talk about our nights. Let's talk about us. Fuck you guys. Let's talk about us. I went to a restaurant called Toca Madera. No? Okay. And apparently there's one in Los Angeles. It was very cool. I had a flaming drink, which I've never usually wanted to do, but I physically can't drink as much as I used to, so I'll drink ridiculous things now. So I had a drink that had like 20 flowers in it, and then they put some sort of, I'm assuming it's brandy or something, on it and on the tray, and then they lit it on fire, and then they sprinkled stuff, which was probably gunpowder, and I was like, delicious.
Is there a rider, like, if your hair catches on fire, we're not liable?
Did anybody sign anything? I think there's a rider on the flights entering Las Vegas. It just says, not our fault. That's it.
If you catch on fire, you know what you did.
Exactly. What happens in Vegas. So I
did that. In Vegas with your eyebrows.
With your eyebrows. And half of your head. Yeah, and that's about it. And then I knew that we had an early pickup this morning, so I was a fairly good girl. What about you? What time did you finish karaoke?
Like 10:30.
Did I say that very Canadian? Karaoke?
Karaoke.
Thank you. No, that's too much. Too much.
Sorry.
Sorry, you guys. Sorry.
We went to dinner for Hilly's birthday, and then came back here and danced it up on the stage, and then I went home and I took a bath.
Oh, those are good tubs, yeah.
And then I went to bed, and I had terrible dreams. I think there might have been MSG.
Would you like to share?
Very violent.
Okay.
I was defending my house against an assault, and apparently I'm an excellent sniper.
Hey! Look at the round of applause you get for that.
So
congratulations.
Weird. So weird. And violent. And not pleasant.
No. I'm sorry you experienced that.
But
also, we have
to know I can defend my land.
That's right. We had a discussion yesterday about how you enjoy dark shows, television
sure.
shows.
No,
so
like
I'm surprised you didn't enjoy your dream more.
Yeah,
how the tides have turned.
Yeah, suddenly. I'm not like a comedy romance girl with my television. I'm like, axes, fighting, dire consequences, good. You know.
Vikings
and like, what was the other, you know, Game of Thrones, like things that are like, you have to turn up the brightness on your television. Mm-hmm. That's the stuff I like.
Kim, you're up. But I also ate sushi until I thought it would come out in my
not
ears.
Not a euphemism.
Not a euphemism. Yet.
It happens in Vegas.
But then everybody went to this thing called Meow Wolf. Do you know what this is?
Yes!
Yes. Okay, so here's the thing. Yes. As they were describing it to me, my people generally can be, you're either a seeker or an avoider. You're a high, lots of stuff, or low, not so much, not. I tend to be no, not so much. I am not a seeker. And visual stimulation makes me go nonverbal. Somehow those wire up. And as they were describing, Stephen Norton is showing me pictures of this. My body started contracting, and I don't think I want to go. And they were like, no, come on. I was like, nope. So they went and enjoyed recreating an acid trip, and I panicked at the mere thought of going. And that is not for me. So I too went back and went to bed.
I saw that video and I looked at you and I was like, why would you do that? Why?
I thought it looked pretty
with
cool.
With strobing lights and like all this
you're
stuff.
You're looking in a mirror and your face melts. That's
do you know what the first thing I thought when I saw that, I was like, that looks fucking cool. I wish I'd gone to that. But there was probably a line to get in. That's why I don't go to things now, is because I'm like, it seems hard.
It seems hard.
I don't care how expensive it is, if it's cool, whatever, but if I have to, like, try, No gracias.
We do, there we go. Because this one's over there like, any second now they're going to start talking about their periods. And I need to be
Krista's
ready to go.
Like, I've heard enough about Brianna's uterus.
God.
Hi, good morning.
All right, hi, Krista.
So you know it's hard to hear you from when we're asking questions.
Yeah, you after you ask the question, you have to scamper over in front of the...
What you guys were doing yesterday. Oh, I was like, why is everybody sitting down so fucking bad? What did I do to offend you? Now I get it. Thank you. Thank you for that explanation.
Just sounds like, wah, 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 wah. We had a better night than you last night because we saw Lin-Manuel Miranda.
Like in the wild?
Yes.
I can't hear you, but Michelle can answer if you're asking a question.
In the wild?
The show.
Oh, he's performing, like songs from his Broadway shows, or?
Hip-hop.
Oh, amazing.
I did a show with him. He was on an episode of House that I was on many, many years ago. And I took it upon myself to assure him that he was a very talented young man. And he should continue with his career because he really had something. So, you're welcome.
Yes. God bless Kim. You should go and guest on his show in Vegas, his little residency. That's cool.
I'm sure he'd remember me. When people talk about who really influenced your career, he's like, there was this one lady who had five lines on this show I was doing. She seemed nice.
So, Sam, you are now a New Englander. It's aunt, not aunt.
Oh.
Also, Sam,
you got spanked, bitch.
Did I say aunt? Who did I say aunt about?
No idea if you just said something, but also since you've all moved to various completely different locations to where you grew up, have you been surprised by any words or sound words once you've moved and been like, what? You know, like the old soda and pop thing.
Oh.
Well, I grew up about 50 miles from where I now live, so I have returned to my roots. My whole thing was moving to California, and honestly still, it wasn't new, but I can't with the vocal fry. I cannot with that.
Oh my god.
Did you get oat milk? Like, you have to move your mouth when you speak. You have to. So that's
just
that
jaw. Only jaw. What?
So that's my thing. I'm back where I belong.
Yeah, good for you.
Where people enunciate.
Sometimes too much, but at least I understand what they're saying.
Well, I think I demonstrated that earlier, where I think because I spend so much time in the United States, a lot of people in Canada think I'm American, whereas then I come here and people go, nuh-uh. So I also work in voiceover, and so when I'm voicing a cartoon, I will often get the notes like, too many O's, tone it down. And in Saskatchewan, where I'm originally from, is the middle of Saskatchewan, also like a lot of farmers who aren't around any city people for most of their lives. So they talk like this, yeah, okay. And you know, they go down to the fields and they do what they gotta do. And you notice it a lot when you go to Saskatchewan. Again, people don't enunciate. I use all of the muscles of my face to talk. And they don't do that there because they don't have to, because they're around people who understand them, just like any other dialect. So yeah, bud.
I have an answer that's going to be interesting to maybe only me. I have moved, and I'm out in the middle of nowhere now, and I found a farm to volunteer at. That includes, one of my jobs is socializing the baby goats. But apparently there is shelters, right? And they're shelters, or lean-tos, might be as far as I go. But our mini donkey needs one, and so I started looking up online plans, because I can't build it from scratch, but I'm willing to try to build it from a plan. I can't find what I'm looking for, and I can't find what I'm looking for, and I can't find... It is called a loafing shed. Because apparently livestock, when they want to be in the shade or out of the rain, they're just loafing around. Like, that is not a word that I would associate with livestock, but it is a loafing shed. I just picked
up that's a technical term.
Cows back there being like, just fucking loafing around.
Stop loafing around, Fred.
Yeah, loafing around. Fred's back in the loafing shed.
Just giving you the middle finger.
Totally.
What it want?
So yeah, loafing shed.
Loafing shed.
It's the name of my house.
The name of my autobiography.
Does anyone else know what that is? Is this news?
Friend
so
in the back.
So two people are like, yeah, loafing shed. I told you, it would be interesting to two people. I've now learned about a loafing shed. But the rest of you know I get to play with fucking baby goats.
When you come to a panel at fucking 9:30 in the morning, this is the shit you're gonna get, okay? I don't wanna hear any complaints. You're gonna hear about the inside of my lady parts and donkeys. There's no in between.
Hello. Hi, good morning. So I have a question for Sam. I was like wondering, so.
Hold on. Y'all are being very rude. Is class settled down now?
Sorry.
Did you bring enough for everyone? I think not.
Okay, sorry, we couldn't hear you. Go ahead.
Sorry, good morning. Hi, my name is Isis. I'd like to ask a question for Sam. So Mary's already come back, but we've already seen her heaven. But how would Mary's heaven have changed now that she's grown, she's come back, she's grown a bit, she saw her boys grown up, she took care of Jack, she saw her husband again out of heaven. And now that she's back, how would that have affected her heaven if we had seen her heaven in the ending?
It sounds like you've really watched this show. I have no idea what she's talking about.
I have a little bit. So I do think it would change because originally her heaven was, you know, just sort of this idyllic bliss with little tiny children and a husband, just, I think, like in a repeat of baking pies that she suddenly can cook. And living in this life that she didn't get to have. I think that would have changed a lot. I don't think her boys would live with her anymore. But yeah, just a much more broader view of what happiness is. You know, just simpler. Not simpler. Less...
Does anybody have any words here?
Yeah.
They're probably found at the bottom of a coffee cup. Ideal? Maternal?
A less stereotypical, like, happy mom life, as opposed to, she's like, sure, I'm gonna go drive the car, you go do your thing, and we'll meet up after dinner. Like, yeah, less typically domestic, like idealized version of a Stepford family, because they aren't that so much. But also everyone living, that would be good.
So what I hear you saying, which I think is really a lovely example for all of us, is that heaven would go from something I never attained on earth to heaven is what I learned to accept and love on earth.
Yes.
Okay. You're welcome!
Thank you.
That's the only thing
Thank
I'm gonna
you.
Have all day. But yes, that is something we can all aspire to.
Yeah. Appreciating what you have and seeing your
greatness.
Oh.
The heavens have parted.
Oh, also Mary would have Starbucks in heaven.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I bet they all drew straws backstage.
Oh, like, motherfucker!
What happened?
I spilled!
Put some on the other knee so they match.
We'll
we'll sort you out.
Who has a Tide stick?
I do, normally.
Or a wet wipe. Does anyone have a wet, like a baby wipe?
What?
But you have to... You're going to need these. We all need to clean our germs now. Does anyone else think a little bit of a germ of foam since COVID?
Talk amongst yourselves.
Wait, here, someone else ask a question while we'll think about it while we're clicking.
While we're doing our laundry.
My darling, hello.
Okay, so my question is a little, like, basic, but I want to know what you guys, like, do for, like, hobbies and for fun, and if you guys get to hang out other than at conventions.
Oh my god. Yes.
That's not a basic question.
You think I would spill my coffee just in front of anybody?
We were just talking about this. Sam Smith and I have been friends since the year 2000. Yeah, so before Supernatural...
You guys gasped too hard at that. I don't know how old y'all are. My friend... Okay, I'm taking up too much attention. Okay.
And then, yes, Brianna and I talk on an average of every 30 seconds. So, yes, these are two of the four people in my world, husband excluded, that I trust with my heart. So, and what do? You already know, I clean up baby goat poop shit for fun. And anyone who doesn't think that's fun has never watched baby goats parkour off of your wheelbarrow.
Parkour.
And that's not a metaphor. Weirdos.
Yeah, I think... you know, we talked, I think, a little bit about this at the PJ party, but there aren't a lot of, I don't know if you've noticed this, there aren't a lot of women on the circuit. And luckily, the women that are on the circuit like and love each other a lot and respect each other and also really are inspired and admire the journeys that we've seen. Like, as Kim said, these two have known each other for such a long time. I've only known them for 8 years, and you gravitate towards people who challenge you and are, I think, a little better at you in arenas that you want to be better at. And I think these two are amazing reflections of that, and I feel so lucky to work with such amazing women, and they're who I want to be around all the time. All the time.
Like Kim said, it's a safety thing. It's just trust and love and know that you will have them and they will have you, and it's just so lucky. I mean, I was so excited. You should have seen us when Kim came up to season 12 or 12, right? Yeah. We were working together and we were like, Kim, you're like...
I was there.
We would like drag our chairs next to each other and be like, take a picture of our chairs together. It was so fun. And I think all the boys on the set were like, what is happening? What's going on? We're like, shh.
Nuh-uh. They were jealous.
Probably.
Boys wish they could be like that.
Yeah.
Right?
I love the fact that you're asking, because what you see, for those of you who are new to the convention thing, you might come for Supernatural, but you stay for the relationships with each other and with us fuckers. So what we are bringing you is real. This is not another show. This is not another set of artifice. When you see us love on each other, we fucking love on each other. We love each other. And that carries through outside of this. There are text threads that prove this. There are mental breakdowns that prove this. There are getting together to help a friend who's in trouble to prove this. So it is real. It exists outside of this. And yeah, hanging out with each other is something we do even when you're not paying us.
Yeah. We see these conventions as a way to see each other, same as you guys. Because especially now that we're all spread out across the globe, like, very few of us live in LA anymore. those of us that did would see each other there when we could, but we always were like, well, it's okay, because I'm going to see her in Denver in 2 weeks. Mm-hmm. We're going to hang out and have our own PJ party.
It's in a way easier to see each other because of work. And yes. I'm sure you are all like that with your work friends. Like, it's hard to see as an adult with responsibilities, with families. When we lived in the same city, I don't think I saw you two. Kim, you, because we were also recording, and she would also cook me dinner on Sundays. But
in Vancouver, I would see you like once every month.
That's most right. When you were shooting, because you everybody's life gets in the way, and it's romantic, right? And yeah, I feel very fortunate that we have these getaways, just as you do, to see our friends and give undivided attention to them. Very lucky. Thank you. Whoever asked that. Hi, Kim.
Good morning. So my question is, what is the most unique, fun, creative event that you're like, holy crap, what am I watching, that you've been to? So I've been learning about different events like porta potty races, pig races, things that just make you laugh and make you wonder what the heck you're even doing there. Like the panels, you know, you guys make us laugh, Supernatural Convention.
We are your greatest event you've ever seen. That makes sense to me, yes.
That's right.
Especially this morning.
I'm your greased pig.
Yeah.
Sometimes I'm your Disneyland ride, sometimes I'm your greased pig. Yay!
I have not been to, I've been to events, but most of the events I go to are stage shows or sometimes concerts. I went to a Lizzo concert recently. That was fucking amazing. I took Valentina. She's her favorite artist, and I surprised her. It was amazing. But I saw on TikTok that they have tournaments to keep balloons in the air. And I was like, oh, wow. These are like, and people win money to win these tournaments. So that was the most interesting thing I've ever seen. I've never heard of anything like that.
It's not unusual necessarily, but I am a big fan of Ren Faire.
Yes!
And I go during Time Traveler weekend so I can dress steampunk. Although I do the costume assistant on Supernatural made me a Renaissance dress. So I can go as that too. But I love going, like, there's jousting and washerwomen, and like, I just love it. You know, turkey legs the size of your arm. Like, it's just transporting to me, and like the Mayday pole and all that stuff. They're so dedicated to the part they're playing, the fairies lounging under the tree throwing grapes at you. Like, it's just, I love it. I love it so much. And it's bizarre. Like, it's, people walk around like, oh, that person has horns. Awesome. Like, it's just, and they're like skipping along, like they have goat feet. Like, they're just dedicated and fully in it. And I love it. I love it.
Sounds like I should be a Ren Faire fairy.
Correct.
I don't want to lounge underneath a bush and throw grapes at fuckers. That sounds like, yeah. I want a loaf. I want my own loafing shit. I want my loafing bush. My fairy loafing bush.
That can be arranged.
Yeah, yeah. I'm in. My answer is probably going to give people some feelings. And I want to acknowledge that, Gish. I mean, come on. I didn't partake often because it was overwhelming and terrifying, but it was also some of the most hilariously joyous expressions of human capacity to create and love and connect that I've ever witnessed. So good on all of you.
Without Gish, I can say with complete certainty that I would not have gone and made my son dance with me in front of the orangutan cage at LA Zoo. That would never have happened. And I think he's better for it.
Thank you.
Good morning, you salacious sirens of Supernatural.
You're such a flirt. Oh, Kim's got a new hair toss.
Speaking of goats, while I was snowbound, I happened to catch a couple of your works outside of Supernatural. Kim your Christmas Beethoven movie, and Sam your Frontier movies. So I was wondering, and I don't know if Bree, if you worked with any animals, but I wanted to hear about your experience, like working with a huge St. Bernard or with horses, if you could kind of explain or describe what it was like to work on film with those types of creatures.
Well, I worked once with an actor named Jared Padalecki. So I'd just like to speak briefly about that experience. No, I'm just...
So
you have a trainer?
No. And it showed. No, I'm just kidding. I'm kidding.
So I shot Beethoven's Christmas Adventure in Winnipeg in January. So at one point it was 40 below zero.
Was this like a take off the Beethoven movie, the original?
It was Beethoven.
Awesome. How did I not know that? I love
Beethoven 8. And this is the one where Beethoven is given the power of speech. Because Santa's Christmas elf drops a candy cane or some fucking shit like that. I don't know. And so we had two, so we're in 40 below, and y'all are gonna say, yeah, but that's Celsius, Kim. And do you know what 40 below is in Fahrenheit? It's 40 below! Fucking, what the fuck? But we were still shooting, and it was so cold that they were saying, don't open your eyes until you hear action. Because even with the salt, we're afraid that your eyeballs will get frostbitten.
Welcome to Canada.
Yeah. Meanwhile, the dog, two dogs, there were two dogs. One was the running picture Beethoven, and the other one was the interacting Beethoven, because the running picture Beethoven still had his nuts and would bite anybody that came close to him. So he was not allowed to interact with us, because he would jump on you and hump you, or bite you.
Welcome to Canada.
Yep. But they also got way more breaks than we did, and got to wear boots that were way warmer on their little feeders than we did, and it was difficult. And that said, I thoroughly approve of how difficult it is to work with animals, because creatures, including actors, should not be interchangeable. And when they can't say, this is uncomfortable and I don't like it, we've got people that say that on behalf of them. The other time that I worked with a horse was on The Sweet Life of Zack and Cody. There was a horse. And I will say it was the first time I realized why there is a phrase, pissed like a horse. Because boy, when a horse has got to go and he's on set, your day is now ruined.
We have a river where the sidewalk used to
be. Wow.
Yeah. So, on that series of the Loves movies, I was a frontierswoman, a grandmother, by the way. This was 17 years ago.
Yeah, but in the frontier.
Welcome to Hollywood.
Yeah. Thanks, Hollywood.
Hallmark step-grandmother, so that made sense. And I'm still friends with the girl who played my stepdaughter, and I think there's a 4 to 6 year age difference. And then she adopted a daughter who was like 25 years younger than her, or 20 years younger than her. So we were a very closely aged family. And I only passed out one time from the corset. But I had a horse on my farm. I didn't get to like ride it or like actually do any acting with the horse, but his name was Dollar. And he and I had a lovely relationship. I had learned this trick not that long before that. And it's so funny because I was like, that's never gonna work. And it still, to this day. So now you all can learn it. When you're standing at a fence and there's like horses in a field, and you know, you call them, you're like, hey, and they just are like. If you stand at the fence.
They say nay.
They say nay. You're like, nay, thank you. Don't look at them and pretend to be eating. Chew. Like bees to honey. They're like, oh, that person is, because apparently in the wild, you're not gonna sit and eat if you're feeling aggressive or threatened. You just eat, so you pretend to chew. like within 4 seconds, he was like, "What are you eating? What are you got?" And we were best friends from then on. And so I would treat him with apples and carrots and peppermints and things when the trainer wasn't looking. It was the best. I'm trying to think. I did work with a dog on another Hallmark thing. The problem is a lot of times they are so focused on their trainer who's off camera that you're like, over here, and they're like, it's very hard to, and they did let me go. They're like, you got to go play with him, like walk him, get him used to you and stuff. And there's a lot of pressure. What if he doesn't like me? What if I do something wrong? But I do feel it's like a little bit like kids on set. I feel a little like, do they want to be here?
Yeah, they're not going to fake it if they don't like you.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
There's no obligation to be like, yeah, we're cool.
Yeah.
That's why you see so few cats in movies.
That's true. Oh, dollar. Thank you, wherever you went.
Thanks, Cheryl.
Hi, ladies.
Hi.
Hi. So I made a statement yesterday about you, Kim, and Brianna being on The Voice. So I'm going to follow through. Sam, I want to include you with this. But I'm going to have to know what kind of power you all would want if I can get you on the show.
Is it Charisse?
Yes.
Thank you. I'm very good with names. Okay, I hope you're taking notes. Charisse here is going to get us a job by the end of the week, we decided, on The Boys. So your pick. Kim and I have decided that we're going to be kind of this, you know, bumbling duo by day, fuck shit up by night, right? Is that what we decided? What do you want your character to be? Because she'll fucking make it happen.
I want my superpower. It's twofold. So I have my cellular structure is it heals. So I have super strength, but also I can heal quickly. That doesn't mean that I can't get hurt. So I'll be in the middle of like fucking some shit up, and then they'll slit my guts open, and I'll just be like, oh, god damn it. Fuck. And I'll like have to, I picture someone who responds to physical injury by going, that really hurts.
Nice.
I don't even know where all these pieces go all the time. God, you're an asshole. Hang on.
Let me fix this.
Like trying to reattach my head after it's been mostly severed and being like, I'm gonna need a cut. That's not aligned right. Could you cut it again? Because I missed.
Like when you crazy glue a plate together.
Yes. Yeah, just like that is. Or asking you to cut my head off again because I didn't get it fit right.
You didn't do it right.
That asshole.
Yeah, oh man.
Or her going, here, let me cut that again. Yeah. That's crooked.
You're wrong. Here, I got it.
Let me do it, Kim. Let me do it. I think my superpower would be my superpower, and it's very similar to my superpower in life, which is that people think that I'm, you know, very sweet and, you know, can be fooled easily, but I will gut you like a fish, given the opportunity. And I like the idea of having the superpower of making people do whatever I want them to do. That was mine.
Yeah, that sucks to be you.
I want to have the Jedi mind trick where I'm like, these are not the droids you're looking for. Like, oh no, okay.
Yeah,
like that.
Okay.
Yeah, you can.
So she
that.
And I.
I'll think of another.
You'll think of another one. That is the wrong key for Jeopardy, Brianna.
That's Twilight Zone Jeopardy.
No, it's all. You're thinking. Think. No.
I like the idea of teleporting. I like the idea of being able to fly. But these are all ones that are already on there. So maybe,
we can repeat.
Can we?
Maybe that's why we aren't series regulars.
Yeah.
Because
that's right.
In the world of they, they're like, well, we already have that superpower, so you can't.
I really like the idea of female superheroes coming on and having versions of the divine feminine wiles be superpowers, which women already have to a point.
Right.
Using it to our such as healing, such as getting fucking gutted and then going, ugh, fine, I'll do it myself, you know? Having people do what you want them to do when they think it's their idea. These are all things we do anyway, right?
It's true. I'm just imagining like sparkles coming out of my fingertips. I'm not sure what they do.
That would be
awesome. I can't
awesome.
Wait to find out.
Well, everybody's just like, ooh.
I'm like,
yeah, they all like just explode.
That would be a running joke, like doing this with the sparkles, and people are like, what is that? And I'm like, I don't know. But everyone's like, oh. And it just stops everyone from what they're doing. They're like, not knowing is scarier.
Also a feminine power.
Although if we were able to repeat superpowers, I wouldn't be mad at being the guy that goes inside penises. Just torn out there.
Is that Ant-Man? What is that?
I don't know the name.
Termite.
And it, termite. Termite. His friend didn't last long. Not a euphemism. fucking Saturday panels!
Good morning.
See, we talked about the inside of men's pieces. For sure, she's run away. Okay, did you get all that? Inside of penises. Thank you. Okay. Well done. Thank you. I look forward to my offer. Hello.
Hi there. This is pertinent to the question, but several years ago, DJ Qualls came to the UK and did a comp, and we convinced a friend of ours that his initial stood for Dorothy Jane, because his mother wanted a girl, and, you know, he was too sensitive to change it, but he just went by his initials. The question is, what is the biggest line of BS that you've ever sold anyone that you got away with?
I have one. Did I answer that too quickly? When I was young, whenever we would go to, like, family outings, like if our family went camping with a bunch of other families or something like that, where I didn't really know the other families, but we're hanging out with them, when I wasn't around my family, this was when I was, like, 6 or 7, I would speak in a British accent every single time, and I would tell people I was from London. I was, like, 7 years old. And they would go, what part of London are you from? And they're all from Saskatchewan. They don't fucking know. And I would say, the central part. And they believed me. That was my favorite thing ever. I always try to convince my daughter, who's 8, to do that. Just like pull one over on people. She's like, Mom, no. She can't believe the audacity I had. Anyway, I love that. Oh, fucking Michael Rosenbaum's here. Michael Rosenbaum. Good luck to you all. That's all I have to say. Okay, yes. Worst thing, lie that you've ever told.
I didn't understand the concept of truth as a small child, but the caveat was got away with. I did not get away with showing up to school using a tree branch as a crutch and telling people I'd broken my leg. I did not get away with telling them the reason we didn't go down into my basement is because tarantulas live down there. I did not get away with any of this, but I didn't know. I just thought they were, I had a tenuous grasp of the concept of truth as a child, and it took me a long time to realize that there was a difference between facts and fun stories I think you should think.
I was much older. I was in my 20s, and I don't know why I decided this was what I was going to do, but I told everyone I was 47. And I stuck to it. Like, up until I was, like, in my 30s.
Like, when you started in your 30s telling people you were 47?
Correct.
Why?
Because people would ask me how old I was, and I didn't think it was any of their business.
Oh, and they'd go, you look great.
Correct.
Oh. That's actually very, that's very smart. That's very
47,
smart.
47, and it was like, wow. They were so confused. What? Like, what? Really? I'm like, why would I lie?
How dare you call me a liar?
And then when I turned 47, I was like, maybe I should stop doing that.
I don't know. I'm 32. Fuck off. I want you all to know I've made the coffee stain on my pants larger. So you're all fucking useless, okay? So have a great day. Thank you.
I feel like it went really well out here just based on that. I mean, walking out here to that, I'm like, this seems like a warm and embraced environment.
Yeah. They made friends.
They made friends. Ladies and gentlemen, Samantha Smith, Kim Rhodes, and Brianna Bo.